On the day of resurrection, the disciples were gathered together in the upper room, the scripture tells us, for fear of the religious authorities. And Jesus came to them and said, "Peace be unto you." Now, as we remember the story, Thomas was not with them on that day. He didn't believe that the disciples had seen the risen Lord. A week later, Jesus came, and Thomas was with them. And Jesus said, "Peace be with you." Now, we might be able to surmise a lot of things about why the disciples needed to have Jesus say, "Peace be with you," but I think at least part of it had to do with the fact that they were afraid that what happened to Jesus was going to happen to them. That is, they were afraid that they would be arrested, they would be tortured, and they would be crucified. And they did not want that to happen, of course. And so they were afraid. They were afraid for their lives, and at least afraid for their physical well-being. And so Jesus came and said, "Peace be with you." Now, when Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene in the Garden of Gethsemane on that wonderful morning, Jesus didn't say to her, at least it's not recorded that he said to her, "Peace be with you," but rather, he said, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who is it you're looking for?" And she replied, "Sir," thinking he was the gardener, "if you have taken him away, let me know where you have taken him, and I will go and get him." And then Jesus said to her, "Mary." And that brought peace into her heart. Then she knew that he had been raised from the dead. And then Jesus commissioned her to go and tell the other disciples what she had seen and heard. In our reading today, from 1 John, we read about another kind of anxiety or fear that the church had. They were worried about whether or not their hearts condemn us. If our hearts condemn us, what do we do? What happens to us when we feel like we aren't really the kind of people we should be? We're not really what? As Christian as we should be? As good as we should be? As worthy as we should be? What are we feeling when we say, what if our hearts condemn us? So John talked to the church that he was writing to about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. So, if a brother or sister is hungry, or without a home, or thirsty, or naked, what do? You help them. So if you see someone in need, and you have material abundance, or even something to share, you share that with the person who is in need. And this is the kind of love, John tells us, that Christ called us to. And by this love, we know that we are God's people. We know that we are in God. God is in us. Because there is the love of God in us. And so, John addresses that anxiety and that fear. In the gospel today, there's another sort of fear that's addressed. And this is, I think, by people who they don't see themselves as part of the church, or part of any religious thing, or even part of God. They're kind of on the outside. And they don't even know if God knows about them, or cares about them, or loves them, or wants them, or anything. And to those, the word of Jesus comes, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep know me." Oh, wait a minute. That's a little disturbing if you're on the outside. "I know my sheep and my sheep know me." What if you don't feel like you know Christ? What if you're one of the ones that are troubled and you think you're on the outside? Or what if you're even one of the ones on the inside, like John is addressing in his letter, and you feel like, do I really belong on the inside? Or am I really, an imposter in here? Maybe I really belong someplace else. I am the good shepherd, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. And then Jesus said, I have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. And so Jesus promises to those inside and to those outside that he will gather everyone together. It's interesting when we look back to the first fear that I proposed for us today, the fear of physical harm, followed by the fear of one fear doesn't follow the other in the order which I presented them. The first fear I presented was the fear of those receiving physical harm. And the second fear is the fear that we don't really belong, we're not good enough. Those of us on the inside aren't good enough. And the third fear is those who aren't even on the inside, or they're not good enough, they're just out there. So the first group of the disciples were afraid for their physical bodies. And Jesus said, peace be unto you. Sometimes those on the inside of the church, those who believe devoutly and fervently in God, are of the opinion that it is God's plan to keep us all safe, and that no harm will come to us at any time. And I remember one preacher, Don Basham was his name, saying it's like wearing a gold cross on your lapel that all the bullets bounce off. So those disciples that were huddled together for fear of the religious authorities met Jesus, received the peace of Jesus in their hearts, and then after the day of Pentecost, went out and began to proclaim the gospel. And in the passage which follows our reading from the Acts of the Apostles today, they were arrested and beaten by the authorities, and then released. And they went home rejoicing that they had been counted worthy to suffer for the sake of Jesus. These are the same people that were afraid that some harm might come to them. And yet when harm came to them, they rejoiced that they were ones that God had chosen to be the ones that bear the mark of Jesus. Counted worthy to suffer shame for the sake of Jesus. The peace that Jesus gave them was not, don't be afraid, nothing will ever happen to you. That wasn't the peace. But rather, it was the peace to know that God was with them no matter what happened. The peace to know that no matter what assailed them in life, even if they were attacked and accused for being Christians, even then the peace of Christ was with them. And in that early church was a young man, Stephen, the first Christian martyr. The mob got a hold of him and accused him of blasphemy. The blasphemy was that he was proclaiming Jesus, and it would be blasphemous to proclaim someone to be God who wasn't God. Of course, if the one you're proclaiming is God, then it's not blasphemy, but that's when it got confusing. And so they began to stone him. And he looked up to heaven and smiled and saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God and said that, and died with joy in his heart. In one of the Gospels, Jesus said, about all the things that would happen, that some of you will be beaten and some of you will even be sawn asunder. And he ends it by saying that not a hair of your head will perish, which is comforting in a way. All of these deprivations and even death will come but not a hair of your head will perish. Jesus is talking about two realities, the important one and the temporal one. And the peace that Jesus gave is the peace that passes all understanding, because it makes no sense from a worldly point of view. The ordinary thing in life is to get enough to eat and get enough to drink and have a warm place to live, and at the end of a very long life, have a few more years tacked on for even longer life. That's our goal in life. And yet Jesus said, I come to bring you peace, and that might include nasty things. But in the course of it all, my peace will be in your heart. But how do we know whether we are those people that God has called? How do we really know if we're the ones that are welcomed into the kingdom? What happens when our hearts condemn us? What happens when we say, well, I look like a Christian, but really I'm a fraud? How do we know in our own heart of hearts whether we're really worthy? And I think John does answer that in that passage today. And it's similar to Jesus' parable he told, which we can read about in Matthew 25. Jesus said, on the last day, the king will gather all the nations and will say to those on the one side, I was hungry and you gave me something to drink. I was thirsty and you... Wait a minute. I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and in prison and you visited me. And they said, Lord, whenever did that happen? And then he said, whenever you did it to the least of one of these, my brothers or sisters, you did it to me. And to those on the other side, the king said, depart from me, you wicked, because I was hungry and you did not feed me. I was thirsty and you did not. And so on. And they said, when did that ever happen? And the king said, well, you did not do it to the least of these. You did not do it for me. So, to come back to 1 John and put that together with Matthew 25 and think about, how do I know whether I'm really who I should be? How do I know if I'm worthy? That's a moment for me to sit back and say, okay, if I have questions about my worthiness, if I have questions about whether I belong in the inside, there's a very simple thing for me to do. Refocus my life and feed the hungry. Give something to drink to the thirsty. Clothe the naked. Find shelter for the homeless. And then I'll be one of those ones whose heart won't condemn me, because I know I'm doing what God has called me to do. And then, at the end of the day, I'm one who can put all my cares onto Christ and know I've tried, succeeded in some ways, failed in others. There's the Good Shepherd caring for me, welcoming me into the kingdom. I do not take my failures lightly. I take them seriously. Help me, O Lord, to reshape and refocus, and tomorrow will be an even better day. Jesus came back from the dead and brought peace to the disciples. Jesus comes to us so that our hearts do not condemn us. Jesus comes to us to bring us from the outside to the inside, that there might be one flock and one shepherd, all together, worshiping and loving God and caring for one another's needs. Jesus calls us all into one great family in God.